Yeah.
Cool. So my name is Rendani. I work for Intellect, place that discovered Vitality. I've been there for, I think, the last 3 or 4 years. So that I built a personal budgeting app. I called it Sparrowbox, which basically just means piggy bank. I built this because I just wanted to explore the potentials of programmable banking. This is basically a system diagram. I built it with Spring Boot and Flutter, the Android app. So I work with Java and Spring at work, so I figured that would be the quickest to get it up for me. And then I haven't done any mobile dev before. So I asked around and people were like, use Flutter. So I decided to go with Flutter. And then I added a key cloak server for authentication. And then we can live on an Oracle database. So I'm just going to show you guys. So I built a bunch of endpoints to just get data. So got a dashboard endpoint that also integrates with the Open API. I used Vince's client for connecting to the Open API. There was just a bug with the Spring one, which I figured what the problem was, but I think he'll get into that later, so I'll leave that for him. So my dashboard endpoint basically gives you your available balance from Investec, and then your total budget and your spend so far, which is from the transactions that you got from the programmable banking. Yeah, it basically gives you your recent transactions and your top three budgets. So for top three budgets, I want to get it to show your budgets with the highest spend. Currently just gets like the first three items in the list. So still very basic. So yeah, and then here, you can get like a list of all the transactions. It supports paging also. So before the demo, I sent a transaction through. So you can take it and categorize it. Just get the okay. So it's been categorized. So if I get the transactions again, it'll have a category assigned to it. Actually, I want to use a different one. Let me use a different one. Yeah, so then you can create a budget from whatever category you have your transactions in. So you can give it a random amount there. Sorry, on Postman, I just have to keep copy-pasting the auth key. So yeah, and then if I call get budgets, sorry. The budget should come up somewhere here also. The demo cat and the budget amount is 1,000 and I've spent 123 so far. So the mobile app, there's the push notification for the demo transaction that I did before. When you click on it, it just takes you to the app. Ideally, I'd like it to take you to a screen where you can like categorize the transaction, but yeah, still work in progress. Sorry. So basically that still working on this. Basically that dashboard REST service feeds the screen. It'll just give you a summary with your balance, your budget, how much you spend, and which how you're doing on your top three budgets and your recent transactions. If you click through on details, it'll give you a list of all the budgets that you have and what percentage you've used up of the budget. I'd like to make these buttons actually work so that we click plus or minus, it like adds to the budget or reduces from it. But right now they don't do anything. So, and then if you click on recent transactions, it'll just show you a list of transactions, which is a very bad UI design, but yeah, it's my first time doing mobile app dev. So yeah. yeah, that's pretty much it. Let's get back here. So my challenge that I encountered, biggest one was mobile app development. Flutter is cool. Takes a bit of the learning curve out for learning like platform specific things, but yeah, it was still a hill for me to climb. Another challenge that I have was how do I securely store the Investec API keys? Because currently they're stored in like plain text on my DB, and I think that's not really very secure. And another challenge I had was local hosting. So every single time I log onto the Programmable Banking API, I have to keep changing to my recent IP so that everything still works. But yeah, those are, I think, one of the biggest challenges that I had.
Question, Rendani, have you heard of a service called ngrok?
No.
It's N-G-R-O-K. It might help you with the changing IPs. It gives you a tunnel with like a static domain name, which you can use. So you like run it on your local PC and it gives you a domain that routes to your IP address, and you can use that in external services. I'll send you a link. Let me just type it
in. Okay, thank you very much. I haven't heard of that.
It's a really cool tool.
Yeah, thanks. I'll definitely check that out. Yeah, if you want to get in touch with me, that's my LinkedIn email, and the code is currently on GitHub. I'd like to clean it up a bit before I put it on the community's source control repo. So just look out for that in the future. Yeah, and then next steps, I'd like to add more functionality to the app. So basically use the backend REST services that I've used. I'd like to also possibly hook into the pre-authorization to decline transactions when your budget is maxed out already. Possibly make it like put a flag on the budget to say, do you want to decline or not? And yeah, also finding a way to store my API keys more securely. And yeah, that's me. Any questions?
What did you think of Flutter?
So it's quite cool. Let's see if I can just open up the... So I'm using it in Android Studio. So most of the UI elements are like templates from like some other open source app that I found. But yeah, it was quite a cool thing to work with. Thank God the Stack Overflow though, because yeah, I had a lot of questions as I was doing this.
Was the UI quite easy to build?
So yeah, so most of my elements are copy pasted from another open source app. So yeah, it's once you like get the hang of like how things should look and whatnot, yeah, it gets a bit easier as you go on.
Was there anything on the Investec API that would like a new feature that would help you like do more with this?
I don't know anything right now because I haven't really like integrated with all of it. Right now I'm just getting like accounts and your balances. So not really that I can think of right now.
Cool. It looks really cool.
Thank you.
Rendani, did you see Adam's demo last week?
Why did Adam demo again? I'm trying to remember.
I think Adam's around. We can. Basically, I think if he explains it, he'll probably do a better job.
Yeah. So I made the bridge available. So
the bridge. Yeah, I remember that.
Forwards the transactions and handles approvals.
I'll check that out. So one thing also is that because I wrote everything in Spring Boot, there was a lot of boilerplate code that I had to write. And from the past demos that I've seen, Firebase takes care of a whole lot of the things that I had to go rewrite. So I'm thinking of like checking out like what other people have done and possibly use that, because I had to write a whole lot of boilerplate code in Spring for this.
Yeah, I'd love to see some mashups. Adam, can you imagine your bridge being used inside that app, or adding any functionality to that app that uses your bridge?
Well, absolutely. I mean, the whole point is that you can interact in both directions. So, sending approval updates back and usage update back to dictate approval. Like that's what it's designed for.
Rendani, have you had any thoughts around transaction approval?
So the only thing I was thinking of was like just declining transactions when you've maxed out your budget. It's just that my worry is the small time space that you have for pre-auths. like from it was like a second or two. So
yeah,
that's what I haven't really hooked into it yet.
We did test something similar to that. We queried a Google Sheet to see if there was enough in the budget, and the network request time was enough to make a call. So I think you would be able to do it. You just want to choose a smart failure state, right? You don't want it to decline just because the network request failed.
Yeah, true. Yeah, we'll definitely check that.
I'm not really a fan of this declining a transaction like when you're at checkout, because that can be really shitty. But I really do like this discussion that's starting around pre-authorizing a transaction. So saying I'm going to go spend 200 grand and then going, forcing myself maybe to be a bit more thoughtful or mindful about what I'm spending, especially if I'm going to a place where I've got endless amounts of spending capacity, engine. The engine quick stop, the Woolworths at engine, not the petrol station. what was the most fun things that you learned, or exciting things that you learned while doing this?
So my biggest exciting moment was the other day when I figured why Vince's REST client wasn't working. So the API, apparently you have to give it a unique user agent. Otherwise it just keeps giving you a 403 forbidden error. So I spent a long time trying to figure out what was happening there. I ended up installing Fiddler on my laptop and then comparing the request that Postman would send to the one that Java would send. And the only differences that I could see was on the headers with the user agent, and Postman sent some extra other things. So I just changed to use a custom user agent and it worked. So that was a big exciting thing for me. But then other than that, also I think building a mobile app and getting everything to work. So it had animations before. I broke them somewhere along the way, so the animations are working now. But yeah.
Okay, sweet. Cool. Any other questions from the audience? Hearing most silence. Or complete silence, so I'll take that as a no. Thanks, Rendani. That's really awesome. I'll upload the video afterwards and add the demo to GitLab, and then as soon as you have your repo up, we'll share that as well. I'd be interested. Vince actually managed to update his repo based on what you found.
I'm not sure yet.
I haven't updated it yet, but I'm really happy that he found the problem.
Yeah, that's really awesome. It's pretty cool that things are different projects are helping other projects kind of find bugs and fixes. It's really exciting. All right, so yeah, well done. Applause. I will be the applauder. Thanks guys. We've got some other reports. And next up it shall be the OfferZen team of Jethro and Markus, who will be showing us the OfferZen Team Spend app. Over to you guys.
Cool. Yeah. Let me just get started and think. Sorry, I'm just going to share my screen quick. Cool. Not sure why it's not full screening. There we go. All right. Cool. Can everyone see?
Yep.
All right, great. So yeah, Markus and I are going to take you through the OfferZen Finance app, which we've named ROS for Recon OfferZen, but also a reference to Roz from Monsters, Inc. I don't know if you remember the movie. She's always watching. So the kind of the main goal for what we were setting out to do was just empowering people inside OfferZen to spend money and then to allow the finance team to actually manage that spend easily and confidently. And you'll kind of see why that was our goal when you have a look at our process. So what happens currently is we have a whole lot of cards that sit in OfferZen that anyone can use. So we all have sort of access to those details, and then we can go spend some money and forget to tell the finance team that, hey, we've actually spent some money on something. And then what happens is the finance team goes around kind of guessing what that expenditure actually is. And they'll often go and try ask various teams where they're kind of their best guesses as to who spent that money. But the downside is they're generally going to be asking that when they recon all the finances at the end of the month. So that transaction could have happened right at the beginning of the month, and they'll come back and ask you about like sort of what happened, you know, 20, 30 days ago. And it's really hard to remember that sort of stuff. So a lot of people just sort of don't respond in terms of saying, hey, that was actually me. The other problem with doing all the financial sort of stuff as well from people sort of saying, hey, this was my expenditure, is it's quite a long process to go through. There's a lot of documents and things to read through and go like, okay, cool, this is how I report this kind of transaction and so on. So it's kind of like there's a lot of process sort of tied up in that. So once sort of the finance team has made their best guesses as to what the transactions are when they're reconning, they export all their transactions from Investec, and then they take those and import them into Sage. So that's all CSV exports, I think. And then they categorize them inside Sage. So there's like quite a lot of steps to that process. There's also a lot of room for error. And that's the kind of the main thing we wanted to fix, is sort of get rid of all of these pain points. So our new process is somebody spending something on the Investec card. And again, well, same deal. You know, you have a few different Investec cards that anyone can use. That will then send out a Slack message. And somebody can go like, hey, I was the one who made that expenditure, and they can categorize it directly from the Slack message. And then all of those categorized transactions can get exported to Sage, and you don't have to do this kind of clumsy jump back into Sage afterwards and categorize stuff. So we wanted to really just streamline everything and reduce the margin for error and simplify the financial team's life. So some of the way this kind of works is we have our Investec cards attached to teams. They can also optionally be attached to specific members. So you can have a person sort of owning a card, but it'll always be attached to at least one or to one team. So each card can be attached to teams. And the reason behind that is that we can then message just that team directly associated with the card. So if we have a look at like what could happen in that process, if somebody spends some money on the people ops card, and people ops for us is like maybe HR and in other companies, it's a little bit different, but that's kind of vaguely what it is. So somebody spends money on the people ops card, and then that is processed by Roz. So we're pulling all the transactions from Investec through the open API. So that's the kind of the big transaction dump. And so we'll grab the latest set of stuff and get all of that. We just poll every sort of 30 minutes for that. And then it sort of processes and goes, okay, cool, some of these transactions are new, and sends out a message to the Spend People Ops channel. So each team has its own dedicated Slack channel, and it'll just give some basic transaction information around that, like some amount and description and stuff. And then we just got a button over there, and all you need to do is click, hey, it was me, and then you can start the categorization process. But that's what happens if you spend on sort of a team card. But if you spend on somebody's specifics card, so in our case, somebody called Zara who works at OfferZen, and her card's quite popular to be spent on. And so if somebody uses her card to buy something, then it also sends out to the Spend People Ops channel. But it's just going to say, hey, somebody spent money on Zara's card. And so it's a minor change to kind of add a little bit of extra clarification where we can sort of surface it. But that's the only real sort of key difference from the user's perspective as to what actually happens over there. Then sometimes we have, like if you imagine a lot of transactions are very similar and they're kind of just recurring over the months, it's going to get really, really irritating if we're just at channeling everyone all the time. And then eventually they'll just stop looking at those channels. So we obviously don't want that to happen either. So basically whenever we have a payment that, or an expense that comes in that we've seen before and we've specifically marked as a subscription payment, so you can categorize things as subscriptions. If we get the same transaction, essentially, so with the same card and the same description, if we get that sort of thing coming through, then we can go like, oh, okay, cool. We can categorize this as whatever the last one was categorized as, assign it to the same people, and then just mark it as a subscription thing and don't send a notification. So that's the sort of the main thing that we do over there, just to limit spamming everyone. But now Markus is going to take you through a demo of what the app actually does in action. So you don't just look at random pictures of things and see something real. There we go. I'll stop. Over to you.
Cool. Thanks, Jethro. I'm going to just share on my side quickly. Right. Can everybody see my screen?
Yep.
Okay, cool. Awesome. All right. So, okay. So what we've got over here now is an example of one of the Slack notifications that would have been sent through as soon as a transaction came through. It basically just gives you details about the transaction, the amount, the description, the date. And then we've got the ability to go and categorize that transaction accordingly. So I'm just going to do that live now at the moment. So I'm just going to click on the link. So once you've clicked to categorize a transaction, you basically present it with this view, which again gives you details about the transaction specifically. And then because effectively the transactions, because they come through and they've got part of the card that was used, but the rest being masked out, we can effectively match that to the card of a team accordingly, because we've got the cards saved accordingly, so which helps us to basically autofill this first drop down, which is basically the team for which the transaction was. Otherwise, what one would do is, for example, you'll just select who made the purchase and what the purchase was for. In this case, I made the purchase myself, and this was for marketing event costs. Once that's done, you can just proceed to categorize that accordingly, submit, and then you greet it with this absolutely lovely screen, which is great. However, there's probably cases where, for example, you made a mistake when it comes to categorizing a transaction, but it's not a problem because admin users on the app can easily rectify that in a sense. So I'm going to open up the admin view and just show how that looks in a sense. So here we are basically presented with the new admin, with the admin view with all the transactions accordingly. The first one over here is the one that I'd recently just categorized, which was for marketing event cost, and it was for myself. However, I made the mistake of selecting the wrong category when it was supposed to be subscriptions. So I'm just going to go and just select subscriptions instead. And it wasn't myself that actually made the purchase, it was Jethro. So let's just update that accordingly. And cool, simple as that, transactions updated, and it's basically effortless for the admin and finance team to sort that out in a sense. There is cases where, for example, transactions will be missed accordingly in Slack notifications and such. And what we've done to address this is we've split the transactions out transactions where everything's basically listed, as well as uncategorized transactions where those specific transactions that haven't been categorized will be listed. So what the team can effectively do is they can just go over here, select the category. So electricity, let's just say, I think that's like, it's office services, cool, that's fine. And then we can just select a team member for that accordingly, being Jethro, for example, right? And there we go, the transaction's been categorized accordingly. Refresh that, and it's gone from the view. What we also did is we made it possible so that we could export all transactions into CSV format for cash reports or for Sage to be used at the end of the day, both of which have the ability to export the last 30 days or the last all-time transactions. So for example, I'm going to select the last 30 days. That's just going to give me a lovely CSV. And as you can see there, all's looking good. It's probably a bit small, but I'll just zoom in a little bit. But yeah, it's been exported into CSV format for Sage, to be used in Sage. One thing just to note on this is that we are going to be updating our export functionality to be working with the Python Sage integration that Imran did. So that'll definitely be changing up in future. And otherwise, what we did is just to give the finance team and admin users the ability to just manage things a little bit better, we just included basic CRUD functionality, such as adding managing team members, teams, and cards. And that's basically it in a nutshell. So I'm just going to go back to the presentation. And then just to give a little bit more information about the source code. So it was last week that Jethro and myself, we made a Ruby wrapper effectively for the Open API, which has been published, and that is sitting on RubyGems at the moment. And yeah, the repo is public and everything as well, so anybody can just grab the gem, make use of it. And also Roz itself, what we did this week was we decided to make Roz open source so that anybody who wants to use it or anything of the sort is more than welcome to do so. It's completely open source. So yeah, it's pretty much out there. It's available to use, and yeah, hope you guys like it. And then yeah, that's basically it. So does anybody have any questions? And yes, Roz is always watching.
I see, Adam, you were asking about the undo, and Dan mentioned that we can roll back. So we do have versioning, and it's basically sort of any change to anything that we've attached that versioning to, specifically transactions in this case, we can undo, but we would have to do that manually. So we'd have to sort of SSH in or hit the Rails console or something like that in order to actually do it. If it became a problem, we could probably add that sort of feature for admins, but at the moment it's going to be from a developer side to do it. But we do have the history.
I have a question.
Sure.
Is there anything on the Investec API that you'd add to make this like easier to use, or like add an extra feature or something like that?
Yeah, if I can... Yeah. So the one I think main thing I would add is an ID that actually comes back from the Open API. So the problem that we had at the moment, and it's not a massive problem, but it is something that it's kind of useful to know about, is so we're creating our own ID from the amount, description, and date, but the date is sort of to the day rather than sort of to timestamps. So it means that there can be a little bit of overlap if you have duplicate transactions with the same amount going to the same sort of merchant. You end up with IDs that clash. And our app basically just sort of assumes that it's already seen that transaction. And so it doesn't sort of save an extra one. I mean, there's ways around it, but there's sort of a lot of hacks to get that working. And we didn't feel it was worth doing the hacks to sort of deal with that. So we'd rather kind of, we've been chatting to Investec to hopefully get an ID back, and that'll rectify the issue.
So I see there's a question from Imran. What does the architecture of the application look like, and the language and storage? So in terms of the architecture of the app, it's just a straightforward Ruby on Rails application that we've basically built in a sense. It's using Sidekick, as well as Sidekick scheduler, to effectively spawn off jobs every 30 minutes to go and fetch new transactions and just sync those, create records on our side, and send Slack notifications. And in terms of where it's kept at the moment, it's basically being hosted straight on Heroku at this point in time. So
the DB
is a Postgres database.
Cool. Imran, I know, is working on a Sage integration. Can you guys imagine using that integration?
Yeah, that's one thing that we're going to be doing for sure, is we're going to be bringing that into our side. Because at the moment, we basically, with regards to Sage, it's just a bit of a manual, it's a manual CSV creation process at the moment, in a sense, and it's still is a bit manual for the finance team to go and specifically take those CSVs and upload them. So we'll be definitely switching that out.
Okay, cool. So then would they just, with that button that says like import to Sage, just import the transactions directly into Sage?
Yeah, I guess we could even remove the button if we got that neat and tidy enough, but it's probably nice to have an explicit, hey, I'm ready to send these off to Sage now.
So it would just automatically sync, or?
Yeah, I think we could probably, I'm not super familiar with Sage. So it'd be interesting to kind of see how that integration works, but it would be really nice if it could be completely silent and just do it in the background for any changes.
If I understand correctly, the way Imran's building it is it'll run sort of every day. It just syncs new transactions.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, that's exactly how it will work, guys. So it will, you can either write it once a day, once every hour, once every minute, and it basically just syncs new transactions automatically over.
Brilliant.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, looking forward to that.
Yeah, that'll be great.
I noticed on the CSV export there aren't, you didn't export categories. So does that not get imported to Sage?
With categories are just for our cash report. We don't use them for Sage. They have different category structure, I think.
Okay. Any other questions?
Anyway, yeah.
I would like to just share something about the project. One of the cool things, I didn't work on building it, but I did do a little bit of design work. One of the things that I think is quite cool about this is obviously team members can categorize their own transactions, and the finance admin can categorize transactions on behalf of them if they forget. And we actually record who categorized the transaction, whether it was the team member or the admin. And we're thinking a cool thing to add would be a leaderboard that shows which teams are really good at proactively categorizing their spend versus which teams the finance team has to chase up. And we can make it a bit competitive and gamified, which would be quite fun.
And then a drone delivers ice cream to the best team. question for anyone in the audience. Can anyone imagine their company using this? So we definitely want to see if we can, if developers will bring, get companies interested in using Investec. That will help kind of drive business motivation for this project to get more resources and to get more interest. We're not trying to force that down anyone's throat, but we're trying to do things that will incentivize that kind of behavior to emerge. So does anyone in the audience have any idea if this would be useful to companies, or any stories at least of how team spend is done in your company? If it's a mess, or if there's another way that you do it, or what tools you use.
I can comment. I love this idea, and I think we definitely can use it in where I am at the moment. The only problem is we don't bank with Investec, so I think that's the big barrier to entry at this point in time. And also, we don't use Slack internally. We use Teams, Microsoft Teams. So maybe we can extend it to obviously instead of sending it to a Slack channel, send it to a I don't know what team calls it, what's team group or something like that, so that's the only thing. I mean, if I'd shown this to our finance manager, he would probably want it yesterday, but he'd go, can I talk to Standard Bank? You know, that's kind of the thing he'd want to ask.
Okay, cool, that's interesting. Anyone else have spend tracking stories from within their businesses that are interesting, or just problems to share? Okay, does it feel like it?
I think from my side, it's very similar situation to what Imran mentioned. With our company, we bank with EBSA. In fact, for most part of it, the discussion's been around that. So far, but most certainly, I think it's something the team would certainly benefit from, taking into consideration how much spending we do, especially when we travel.
Okay. And how much, or how do you guys currently track spend, or how do you manage it?
So we use EBSA. So EBSA's provided the company with a set of tools that teams have access to, pretty much do something very similar to a dashboard view where you can monitor your tracking and your spending, but with very limited functionality.
Okay. And how would you want to extend that functionality? Is there some functionality that you've seen here that you would want to use there, or
Yeah, most of the functionality that's been shown today as well, actually stuff we would want to use. So if I could just briefly outline some of the stuff we do with the current systems, it's mostly a manual process upon our return from a travel, let's say from Germany. We'd have to manually export our spend patterns and then submit that to HR as well as the finance department. So obviously something like that would be much more constructive or beneficial to us if it was digital to begin with.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I think what's actually quite interesting having done this project on the OfferZen side is from what I can tell, the dev team or our tech team doesn't spend that much time worrying about fintech apps for our business. I think you guys had to do quite a lot of discovery for this, Dan, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I mean, we had many sessions with the finance team. It was very interesting to get some insight into their world. They're definitely not programmers.
And what do you think is the reason for there not being much activity previously in, like, between the two teams?
Between the tech team and the finance team?
Yeah.
I mean, I would guess that people aren't used to innovating in finance, and there's just maybe a lack of imagination. Now that there are, like, interesting things you can do, probably people would be more likely to do it, but no one really thinks, oh, cool, I'm going to build a cool finance app, because they don't have examples of cool finance apps. So, yeah, it's generally quite hard to integrate with bank systems.
Right. I'm just reading Tian's comment here as well. In terms of accounting Sage integration, you need to export the account categorizations, perhaps having a map from your team. That's the accounting and accounting cuts. Okay, cool.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Is there any idea to maybe give the teams, or at least the people who are going to use the cards, a app or something, so that they can categorize and allocate immediately, rather than waiting for Slack message and then I did it. And so wherever you are, as you make the spend, it pops up a notification on your phone or whatever the case is. And then, I don't know if those cards have NFC, so you could potentially use NFC to register that you've taken that card. And then that's how it could link sending you the message when you do the spend. But yeah, I don't know if Investec cards have tap or NFC or anything. But yeah, is there you guys thinking of that?
I guess what you could do is you could use the after transaction in the card to send you a text message straight away, or some kind of rich email. And then you could have a button in your email that you press. So you could definitely do more real-time stuff.
Yeah.
Use the API, which meant polling for transactions. So the turnaround time is a little bit slower. But you could definitely do it immediately as well if you had the use case where people are out and they just want the thing to pop up on their phone. Yeah.
So I think Dan looked at this in particular was matching the kind of after transaction stuff with the open API, because obviously the open API actually gives all the transactions, where the after transactions only links specifically to sort of card expenses. So it misses out a few things. And the descriptions right now don't quite match, but if we, I think Investec is currently looking at getting IDs that allow you to refer to both sides. So you can kind of actually match those up, in which case, yes, we could do something like that, which is a bit more kind of actionable at that moment. That'd be really cool.
Yeah, we wanted to get the EFTs and all the other stuff as well that doesn't happen on card swipe.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Yeah, Tian's saying that there is already in-app notifications. So yeah, you could add a button or a web view or something.
Alrighty, it is time, and so I think it's time to call it maybe as well, unless anyone wants to quickly turn on their mic and start shouting out questions. I don't feel like that's going to happen though. Thanks Markus, thanks Jethro, it's really awesome, and super beautiful design as well. It's nice to see, obviously you guys had a lot of time, you were allowed to work on that during work hours, so you were able to put a lot of time into it, but really amazing. Thanks so much. And Rendani, also, I'm really impressed with how much you've managed to do since last week I pinged you and you were like, oh yeah, I'm starting now. So that's also really awesome and well done. It seems like you learned a lot. It will be quite cool to have a Flutter app on the GitLab as well. So thanks everyone. I will post all the recordings and repos and things. Thank you very much for joining. Have a good evening.
Can I update from the Investec side, Ben?
Not really. Sorry. Okay, yeah. Cool. If you want to bounce now, you can. There were those two releases, which were just slight updates to the API, which I posted in Slack. It's included transaction date to get account transactions and include date range filter to get account transactions. Yeah.
And I thought we might have them here to chat about that issue with that we were chatting about in the Slack, the after transaction and the declines.
Yeah, so everyone's welcome to go if you want to stick around for this conversation, you may. I don't know if Willem or Wayne has put on his camera. So
I can quickly talk about anybody that just wants to understand that a bit. Sorry, I'm in my living room. I'm making... So, okay. Just the question around the transaction, syncing the transactions between the root engine and the transaction ID from the API. The way these card transactions work is when you swipe your card, it sends like a pending transaction to our card system. And then I don't know if you know how all of this works. I'm just doing a basic rundown there. And then, a day later, the merchant basically gives you a file which confirms that they've received the goods and that everything's fine. Because with Visa and MasterCard, you have a day to like basically dispute any credit card transaction. So I think what the problem we're running into is that when you swipe it, that pending transaction that's happening that the merchant sends us immediately, it's different from the one that you're going to pull out of the API a day later when it's actually confirmed. But you're trying to actually tie the two things together. And I think that's where the challenge is coming from. So we're looking at trying to find ways to keep them as close as possible. Like a very obvious thing, you would think the transaction description would be the same since it's like it's both coming from the merchant, but we found out that it actually changes between you swiping the thing at the POS and actually the real transaction is coming through. So we're just doing some work to try and, I'm not sure if it's always going to be perfect to sync them because of the mechanism of how cards work, but try and get them so that you can at least correlate the two together. That makes sense.
Cool. And then Wayne, I think
that would be a challenge just out of interest around trying to do the real-time things because that card transaction could get like canceled. So you can't take it as gospel until the actual transaction comes through a day later. So you can sort of do indicative things, but you can't go and update your accounting system because, for example, because that thing might reverse out and then you're gonna have to do reversals and then it gets all admin-y quite quickly.
Is it possible to match the transaction when the transaction is actually made the day later?
That's what we're trying to figure out. Like we thought obviously the IDs are from different systems. So that's something we can think of. I would have thought at least the description we could like match on, but that also seems to be a file. So we're doing the work to try and figure out how do we tie those two things together so that you don't end up having a transaction in root. And then when you pull the API, you can't like link the thing somehow. So we're doing the work now. We're trying to figure out how that the best way to connect those things together. We are going to put in a transaction ID. We're trying to get the real transaction ID of those systems to come up. Obviously working in a bank, those changes are quite complicated sometimes, especially in COVID with all the lockdowns and headcounts. But so if we don't get the real ID through, we're going to try, we might have to do something similar to what the OfferZen guys do and just create like some form of a hash that at least you get consistently out of the API. But we definitely, I think the big issues we're working on that we know about is the transaction ID, like the ability to uniquely identify transaction. I think that's a key one. Some form of an eventing thing. So like everybody's building polling mechanisms on top of the API. Like is there some way to subscribe and maybe generate an event? We're looking at that. Syncing the transaction. Cool. So between root and the transaction ID. Okay. I don't know if Willem and them are here. I think, yeah, that and like just I know it might sound a bit, oh, but like if you currently use your token, it's sort of in your name. We want to just make it a bit more abstract so that when you go in and you create the token, you can almost create like a system, a service type of token, not like your individual one. So they can give some form of a permissioning and rights on those tokens. So it's not like this token can go bananas in your online banking account. We just want to lock it down to some extent. That makes sense. So we're doing some work around that.
And that's primarily from an API perspective. From a programmable card perspective, though, Ernie and them are in the process of just finalizing the implementation that would give you additional context around why transactions got canceled. So we ran into an issue essentially where the root programmable card engine wasn't like available at that point in time. And what happened was our card system basically went on and approved the transaction, which is fine or as expected. But the flip side of that is this has actually raised a transaction declined type of event to the root programmable card platform. So that was a bit misleading. So I think initially, when we initially launched, there was a separate event that would actually fire in event of declines. What this change will do is actually just always raise the on before and on after transaction, but it would actually give you context around in the event of a decline transaction. It would actually give you some proper context around why. And then like in the same instance, you would actually be able to identify in that context that the root programmable card engine was actually not, or your on before transaction, so let's say event actually didn't occur at all. So whatever you had there was probably like ignored, just so that you know. And then also the change that will allow you to persist code separately from publishing to your card. So you could then like essentially code multiple versions and then choose whatever you want to publish or a card.
Cool.
Ernie, did I miss anything? I see you were there as well.
I think that covers it. Yeah, so on the after transaction, you'll get the code as well as the reason for what happened. So for example, if it's a successful transaction, you'll get a code of 0 and it will say transaction approved. In the case where the root engine was unavailable when it tried to, you will get the code for it and it'll say the engine was unavailable, or you'll get insufficient funds if you didn't have money in the account. So all of those kind of things will now come back as a new a new set of properties on inside the after transaction or that transaction object. And then yeah, with the save and publish change, this first iteration gives you the ability to have a set of saved code and a set of code published to your card. So you can also run your simulator against the two different sets of code. So you can run the simulator against what's currently running on your card or against the code that's saved, and you can switch between the two. It's kind of the first step towards allowing versioning, essentially. That's kind of where we are.
Cool. Okay. Did we answer all the questions? I know that was a bunch of rambling from all of us.
Yeah, no, I think that covered quite a lot of the stuff we were looking at, or at least we were discussing in the Slack. Hey, Ben, would be interesting is how are the card reversals then handled currently? Like, so if a transaction is reversed, where does it end up in terms of the programmable banking?
It will basically just disappear off of your transaction history, and that's the weird part. So like if you had to go for
yeah, it is the weird part.
So when you pull your deltas, you'll probably just see the transaction is suddenly missing, because they're like I can explain to you like logically when I buy something. Let's say I go buy something at the shop and I swipe. You go into online banking and see there's that pending transaction section in Investec Online on top. Now that one converts into a real transaction like a day later. But if somehow I went and disputed it with a merchant, that line would just disappear, the pending one. So that's why I'm saying it's almost like we need to explain better the mechanism of how these transactions work so that people don't assume that, like, there's some level of persistence on those transactions before they actually happen. Obviously, EFTs go through real time. So it's also like nuanced around what type of transaction you're doing. But I think the best way would be in your DAO title just disappear, which is going to be a bit strange. But like, that's just reality.
Okay.
Yeah. So there was quite a big discussion last night in the community Slack, just for the investor guys, around after transaction running and after decline running. So firstly, like when you simulate a transaction, it always runs after transaction. It never runs after decline, even if you decline the transaction. So the simulator works different to the production thing. So I'm not sure if that's going to be fixed, but that was one issue. And then the other issue was that after decline ran on a real transaction after it was approved, which I think is the one you mentioned now. That was probably also the root engine timing out or something like that.
Ben, on the simulator, it doesn't actually run through the card rail system. So that's why you will always get the both after, before and after. It's difficult because it doesn't actually follow the same process. It's not triggered always Visa.
Yeah. And yeah, I think it's always going to be that way. Like the simulator, you're literally detached from the systems because you're trying to just test the code, not really sending it into a core system. There's no dev core system that you're working off, and that's, I think, part of the issue. Yeah.
I think just if you guys are aware that it's like a little bit confusing from the dev side, and you can make probably just explain it better.
Yeah, so we're trying to like do like if you imagine trying to test like a rule, so you're expecting the if the rule says decline this transaction, then you're expecting it to either hit the after decline and hit the after transaction with some sort of message saying decline or something saying false or some mechanism to know, okay, this thing was declined, which I think from what you guys explained will be solved by the changes you're working on now, provided that in the simulation, it at least does the same thing. So if in the before transaction, for some reason, some rule ran and said decline this transaction, then the after transaction should have context of that happening.
I
think is what you're saying is happening.
Sorry, I think you guys are downplaying the effect of having the simulation behaving differently to the real life. My initial experience with using the programmable bank cards was that I was relying on the simulation to test my code. And then when I went out into the real world, I just kept getting declined and I couldn't figure out why. And everything from the simulator had come back fine. So I assumed that there was some kind of problem with the code. The problem is, in addition to that, is that the stuff isn't documented. So we need this to be very, very clear for us as developers, what's working, what's not working, what we can rely on and what we can't.
100%.
I will share that conversation that we had in Slack with you guys because I know you don't always get visibility on that.
If anybody's interested, what we can do is just Ben, put them in contact with Aaron's, and when they've done that piece of work, maybe we can just run those scenarios through with him, and they can just test of what of those scenarios are being covered by his fix, and then at least we know exactly if there's still something missing.
Cool. Awesome.
But it's great feedback. I love that. We must keep on coming with all the feedback. Eh? It's like amazing. That's how we're building this thing up. So like, don't be shy. Just bombard us. It's good stuff.
Great. Cool.
Alrighty. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Cool. Thanks, guys. Sorry for hijacking, Ben.
No, thank you. I mean, I almost skipped the whole Investec update section. I think that was a really useful conversation. So thanks. It's good to know you're
okay. Back.
We can continue the drawing.
Continue the drawing. Yay. No, I'm going to eat food now. Supper time. Thanks again, everybody. Thank you.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
Thanks, Ben. Thanks as usual.
Thanks, guys.
Cheers.
Cheers, everyone. Yes, I've reached quite a few women who tried to show interest.